So, welcome everyone. It's going to be a bit of a double act between Buddhasevaka and myself. We're going to start. We're going to, as Buddhasevaka says, it's a bit multimedia. So there's going to be some entertainment, hopefully, and we must make sure there's time for people, for you guys, to ask questions about Big Sit. But to start with, I'm going to introduce Buddhasevaka. He's going to introduce me, and then we're going to show you someone else on the video, if that's okay. So Buddhasevaka, who you can see on the screen there, he comes from Manchester. He joined the order in 2022, which was last year, I think. He's a partner, a father to three, a Dharma practitioner, and an MS-er. Which is a new term for me, which is someone who has multiple sclerosis. He's found the Dharma invaluable in helping him with this condition and has developed a set of meditations to work with it. And he leads the local conveners group for the Taranta Earth Sangha in Manchester. So that's Buddhasevaka.
Yeah, thank you, Jeremy, and everyone's welcome to join that local convenience group. If you so wish, just drop me a line, buddhasevaka@gmail.com. Be very pleased to hear from you, actually. So just reading Jeremy's blurb, so he seems to have settled in Cambridge, having lived in many other parts of the UK over the years. He's a photographer by trade and has two grown-up sons. He found Buddhism 11 years ago through a woman he wanted to date. They are now partners, so he did pretty well out of it. She was ordained in 2021, and Jeremy has been invited to the next year's ordination course at Gukkiloka. Ethical activism has been a part of his life for many years, in some weird ways, including starting up a vegan cafe and venue. He also co-founded the Silent Rebellion and led to the Big Sit. And he sees activism and the Dharma as almost identical. So, yeah, that's both of us.
Thank you. Controversial statement at the end there. Right, should we let someone else speak now? This is going to be Alice, who is a Mitra in Cambridge, in the UK, and this is just under a minute. Hope you can all see that, and hopefully you'll be able to hear it too.
So the Big Sit is a really simple idea. People who are concerned about the climate emergency and the future of our planet come and meet in a public place and sit together in silence. We don't get in anyone's way, we just want to provide a moment of calm amongst all of the busy shoppers. I find it really supportive to sit with others who share the same concerns as me, and I come away from the Big Sit feeling hopeful and connected and better able to engage with these issues in my day-to-day life. So if you give the Sit for Life on Earth, then come and join us. We meet on the last Saturday of every month at 2 p.m. And if you want to find out more details, you can go to bigsit.info.
Great. That bit about when to meet obviously was only at that time in one city. It's broadened out a bit since then. Anyway, I hope that says something about what Big Sit is. And I imagine everyone who's joined this session is intrigued by it. So Buddhasevaka and I are going to kind of ask each other some questions about it that hopefully will unfold understanding of what it is and hopefully inspire.
Yeah, so I'm just, first question to you, Jeremy, is what started it off?
Yeah, so I could spend all day telling you about this, but I won't. We started in December 2021, so 2 years ago. It was in Cambridge initially. It spread quickly to London, Manchester, Bristol, and other places, I think. is basically an offshoot from Silent Rebellion, which was something we started in Cambridge in 2019, in autumn 2019, so well before the pandemic. It was started by some Cambridge XR members who were also Buddhists, as an alternative for some people who wanted to express their concern and their compassion, say their our concern and our compassion, with no disruption. So more of a contemplative approach than XR actions tended to have. So yeah, Silent Rebellion was a street meditation format under the XR banner that the Buddhists did, and it grew. It was big straight away. It really took off, and it also found success online during the lockdowns, and it's still going today. In fact, Silent Rebellion. It's spread to many cities overseas. I'm saying that from being in the UK. Sorry, Tasmania, Switzerland, Edinburgh, Germany. I don't know, quite a few places, I think, started Silent Rebellions on the same format. And yeah, still going today with weekly sits in a park in central Cambridge, and a monthly sits online led by a Buddhist teacher, older member, usually. But numbers started to drop off with Silent Rebellion. And we realized, I mean, the media had really found a dislike for the disruptive nature of a lot of environmental activism. And felt a lot of people didn't want to come along to Silent Rebellion because it was associated with that. You know, it's interrupting people's lives in a physical way. And myself and many others felt, well, let's do something else. Let's do something that's not under the XR banner, but still the same format. So we came together and came up with a big sit as a name, and a leaflet, and started sitting really. So 2 years ago, 50, the first one, 50 people came along in Cambridge, which, you know, with not very much effort. And yeah, we positioned it as being made up of ordinary people and faith groups. And we were all Buddhists who started it, but we approached other faith groups and other people who shown interest in these sorts of things. Yeah, we continued in Cambridge every month. So I've done about 20 now. And it spread quickly to London and those other cities. And we now kind of coordinate across those cities a little bit so that we help each other out. Yeah. Probably stop it. That's how it started.
Okay. So you said who else is doing it from the, you know, from your beginnings, but what's the overall ambitions for the project? What do you hope to achieve with it?
Yeah, it's a bit like ambitions and achieve. Those aren't words that really match, to be honest with this. I mean, I don't know what words do, but it's like, in a way, a slightly subversive. We don't have to achieve anything. We can just sit meditating or just in silence in public. So achieving is difficult to define. It's difficult to answer that. I mean, I'd say what happens is people come along and they articulate their concern and their compassion for the earth and nature in a non-disruptive way. In a really visual, it's a bit like a street performance, I think. It's not really got a performative vibe to it, but anyway, we can talk about more of that later. So what do we want to achieve? I think there's two kind of people who, two audiences, if you like, which is not the right word, people who sit. Well, I can speak personally and from other conversations I've had. It's a very powerful experience just sitting in public with my eyes shut, usually. Sort of meditating in some way. It's a way I can articulate without words something of, there's an alternative. I don't have to go shopping. I don't have to follow my craving. I can be with others. I can interrupt my craving a bit, and I'm kind of showing that in public, as it were. It's a bit weird. It's very weird. And the other audience is people who see us. Most of those are confused. Buddhasevaka may have other thoughts about this, but I think most people are confused about us. We have a leaflet and we do outreach, which is absolutely crucial. So one or two people, sometimes three of us, will offer conversations to the people and hand them a leaflet. All very friendly. The whole thing is a very positive experience, very friendly. Now most people just ignore us. They turn away. Actually, you see them turning away, turn their face away, don't want their children to look, type thing. We get some heckling, not very much, but some. And some people, I think we could be a fourth sight. Some people, those with little dust in their eyes, maybe. I mean, that's how I imagine it anyway. Sometimes I see that where people, sometimes it communicates with it, kind of reaches into people's values a bit more directly in a non-conceptual way. I'm
Well,
hard.
sorry, Jeremy.
No, go on, go on.
Well, I was just kind of reflecting today that what are we going for refuge to, and I thought, well, I'm sort of in this housing estate, in this house, surrounded by all these things, and actually, I'm warm, I'm safe, and actually that's what people glean security out of all of those things. And whilst obviously many of those things are necessary, it's not it won't it's not what we go for refuge to. So instead of being clothed in all of these things, we're almost like we're almost acting in the opposite direction. So we're meditating on the street in full view of people. People, obviously, they might not realize exactly what we're doing, but we're going for refuge to the true refuges, and not the false refuges that quite a lot of people can account on. So it is we're kind of working in the opposite direction to much of society. So in that way, I think we're sending quite a powerful message, really. And like you say, if there's a few people that have a lot of dust in their eyes, maybe this will be the sight that they need to see, or that will act as a transformational tool for them in their lives. And yeah, so I think perhaps it is a ripple effect. We can start with ourselves, and then hopefully go out wider and wider.
Yeah, I like the idea that we're sort of showing an alternative refuge or something. And of course, this is language that is hard to use, but yeah. I mean, for some people, it's meaningful and inspiring. It's a very small subsection, and they're the good conversations we have. And sometimes they then join us. You've probably found this in Manchester too. That they'll join us in the subsequent months. And every time someone sits with us, every time we'll put a chair out or cushion out saying, please join, take a seat. There you go. And people spontaneously sit with us.
And the amount of leaflets I gave out last week, there must have been 20 or so. And then those young kids, inquiring, very nicely inquiring to what we were doing. Very polite and respectful, but we plonked ourselves outside of Next, so there were people coming out with big shopping bags, and then saw us. It's just a bit of a, I suppose it's just to offer an alternative to that there is another way to be. And again, as I said yesterday, I think especially coming up to Christmas, it seems to be more stuff, more stuff, more stuff. But I suppose with this, it's like, well, what can we leave behind? How can we live a more simple life? So that's a very powerful message to me. I wonder whether now we should play the Paramy video. What do you think about extra prayer? Can we do that? Oh, my God.
Well, thanks for speaking to me today, Parami, and and just taking some time out to just well, galvanize us really, and sort of get us sitting on the streets of Manchester. So I'm just wondering why you think it's so important, why sitting quietly in meditation rather than taking some direct action is quite, is such a powerful thing to do.
Well, first of all, I can really understand why people question that. Just to put that out there, I can really understand why it feels maybe even a little bit frustrating when there's so much awful things happening in the world. And, there's a particular, I think we're really geared up to act when we think that something needs to be changed or protested against or highlighted. So I can understand why it's quite a leap to think to just go and sit quietly somewhere might actually have an effect. I can really understand that. And I guess, over the years, I've felt myself shift in that sense. I mean, this might sound a bit strange, but when I was growing up, I had two aunties who were nuns, Catholic nuns. I grew up as a Catholic, and one of them was a contemplative nun. She was behind the bars. This was way back in the 50s and 60s, and we used to go and visit her two or maybe three times a year, like Easter, Christmas, or whatever. And she would sit, literally sit behind a grill, and we would talk to her. And I thought she was absolutely beautiful. She had this lovely, calm kind of demeanor. And I had another auntie, they were sisters, and who was also a nun, but she was a missionary nun. And she was a medical missionary because she'd trained as a nurse before becoming a nun. And she was out in Africa. So she used to come home and visit where I lived with my granny, and she used to come stay with my granny, and she'd tell us these tales of all these wonderful things she was doing, like in the jungle, and converting the natives to Catholicism. Now, looking back at it from the perspective of today, I can see the problems in that, but the fact was she was doing good in the world, it seemed. And at that point, when I was maybe 10 or something, I wanted to be a nun, but I couldn't decide which of those nuns I wanted to be. Did I want to be a contemplative or a out there saving poor, poor people of Africa or whatever? Excuse me. And one of the things I feel eternally grateful for in Buddhism is I don't have to make that choice, that I can be both contemplative and active in the same person, the same as a Buddhist, as a member of our order. I have many opportunities for contemplation and many opportunities to act. So I don't know if that's relevant, but for me, I guess it's like I've found in my practice as a Buddhist with concerns about the world that I need both of those things really. And I think not just in my own personal practice, but I went to offer both those things to the world. So, you were saying to me before we started to record that you go and sit in the streets of Manchester and just sit, as it were. And I think that can be a very powerful message for people. We did, when I still lived in Valencia and I was chair of the centre there, we did that a few times. We did that during the Iraq war. We just went and sat in the streets, and people really noticed, and we had a big banner that said in Spanish, obviously, "Hatred will never cease by hatred, only by love can hatred be conquered." And people would come up and ask us about it, and it really did kind of have a It had an effect, even if it maybe wasn't the most immediate and obvious effect. It definitely did. So, I don't know if that quite answers your question. It was a bit long-winded, but
No,
you know,
that's great. And I think a change of consciousness. I mean, I was listening again to Saraha, I think he's called, his talk in the Tri Ratna Earth Sangha yesterday. And I think he took from Joanna Macy,
Yeah,
certain ways of
three.
being that. Yeah, three. Yeah. And I think he adapted it, didn't he? And
I
so I
haven't heard. Yeah,
yeah.
I haven't listened to it yet.
So I certainly thought.
Yeah, but sorry, I'm talking over each other. You go.
No, I was going to say, so I think certainly a change of consciousness. If one person passes by and encourages them to look more into meditation, look, there's a different way of being, then that surely is a huge deal, really.
Absolutely. June last year, oh no, actually it was quite a few, it was a couple of years ago now, it was before the COVID pandemic began. Our Glasgow Centre, we've got a social action cooler, and we organised sit-ins, as it were, in George Square, which is a big square at the heart of Glasgow, on Climate Fridays, you know, the Fridays where the young folk were kind of coming out of school, and we would just go and sit there in George Square, because that's where there was every Friday there were some school kids marching into George Square, so we would be sitting there. And again, we had a banner saying a whole load of things. We had things around our neck as well saying CO2, co-conditioned, I can't quite remember what it was, but and you know, love in times of sorrow and stuff like that. We had quite a lot of things, and people like the kids would come up and sit with us sometimes, or and we always had one person who wasn't actually meditating who could answer questions or have a chat if people wanted to have a chat. I had some amazing meditations. You're sort of sitting there and there's all this noise and music and people walking past, and I actually had some of the strongest metta bhavana practices I've ever had, because it just felt like we were right there in the middle of something in the world, and at the same time showing another way to deal with sorrow or our grief, really, you know, both that for ourselves, but also we were offering that to people that were coming by. A lot of people came and sat with us. Again, the summer was easier, I have to admit. Yeah, it was easier sitting in the sunshine as well. I found it easier sitting in the sunshine
Yeah, definitely.
than sitting in the cold
Yeah. Excuse me. Yeah, because I was thinking there's many different ways to communicate, and sort of a non-verbal way, such as sitting peacefully in meditation with some banners, that seems like quite a very strong message to give, really.
I think so. Yeah. And on those Climate Fridays, we found that a lot of young people were really interested. You know, a lot of the sort of secondary age school kids, so maybe like 15, 14, 15, 16, were coming up. And some of them were coming and sitting with us. And some of them were coming and asking about why we were doing that. So, really interesting kind of dialogue going on. Yeah, and going back to your comment about Joanna Macy's stuff, because I did at one time do quite a lot of work with her. And those three things that she mentions are stop actions. So that would be your protests and even, you know, maybe taking action, taking direct action. One of them is to analyze the current society's issues and create alternatives. And that's an important one as well, which I sometimes think gets a bit forgotten. You know, so it's important to also be offering alternative ways of dealing with things. And the third one is a shift of consciousness, as you mentioned. And the point in that being that if we just buy into the kind of polarization and buy into the kind of current discourse, then there's a danger you become part of the problem rather than part of the solution, to use that kind of terminology. So I think to allow ourselves to show that we believe that a shift of consciousness is possible, And more than that, it's essential to really make the changes that we'd like to see in the world. So I think a silent sit is can be like very powerful. I think the optics of that can be very powerful. We did get interviewed for the radio a couple of times as well, like, why are you doing this kind of thing?
Yeah, it's quite because when
People
it's
respond.
people really respond to that, don't they? And
Yeah.
so we're changing the location today from St. Peter's Square, where the library is, and actually where
Yeah.
there's been some
Yeah.
quite noisy demonstrations, Palestine type really, quite big events really. So it's been quite noisy, but we're going to be moving today to St. Anne's Square, which is more of a shopping district. So it's a bit of an unknown quantity
Yeah.
today. So I suppose, I mean, people will be coming out of shops and with their carrier bags and things and thinking, well, actually, do I really need this stuff? So even if there's just a little thought there that's implanted, I mean, that'll be job done really, I think.
Yeah, it'd be interesting. Do you have do you take banners or anything verbal, or is it purely a seated?
I've got a banner. Well, we've got a couple of banners, and I burn incense and things. And we've got a singing bowl, and we do the transference of merit at the end.
That's nice. Do
Yeah.
you start together at the centre or anything, or do you just meet in?
Well, we have been doing sort of prior to today. We've been starting at the centre and then moving down to St. Peter's Square. But this today
Yeah.
is like a bit of an
Oh, it's
unknown
clever.
thing, so
Yeah.
yeah, I'm really not sure how it's going to go. But I've had a few like a handful of people saying that they'll be up for it. So I'm kind of hopeful that the world grow
Good.
it.
Good. Do you still have in the Manchester Centre a very long time ago? You did have a little group. I can't remember what it was called. It was M something, and it was like looking at a bit similar to what we've got in Glasgow now as a social action cooler. It was a group of people who wanted to work together, looking at ways to bring awareness both into the Sangha and out of the Sangha about kind of current world issues and how we as Buddhists might respond to that. I think it kind of fell apart at some point.
Yeah, I think the latest thing is myself and Apeksha Priya are doing the we're the Manchester conveners for the Tree Ran Earth Sangha, and so we're just in the
Great.
hopefully we're going to be mandated by the centre soon, in which case we'll be able to advertise on the website and get plug into the Sangha more. But at the moment we're kind of a little bit on the edge of it, so it
Yeah,
feels like
start
it's a
with
bit of a
something.
transition. Yeah.
Yeah, good. I mean, we formed this quite a few years back now, Social Action Cooler, and we kind of spent a few meetings just talking about what we thought the purpose of it was. And it seemed that there were a number of purposes, and one of them was to feed and resource us as practitioners with an interest in social action, but very much looking at the dharmic underpinnings of that social action. And our mandate was from the Centre Council is was I'm not so much part of it at the moment. I helped set it up, but I really wanted some of the younger folk to kind of take it on, and that's happening now. So the partly it was like feeding ourselves in a way, but the other thing mandate was to think about appropriate actions that we could maybe take. So something like those things of going and sitting in George Square meditating during Climate Friday and stuff. So the mandate holder would take that to the council and just let them know what we were doing, so that it was always in relationship to the Buddhist Centre's purpose, really, of teaching the Dharma. So it was never something that kind of split off and became overly politicized, although obviously there's a political aspect to it, but we really wanted it to be plugged in to the Dharma and plugged into the centre's general kind of teaching.
Yeah. No, I mean,
Seems to work well.
Yeah, I've been really reflecting on this kind of stuff just recently, and it started actually by your recitation of the Metta Sutta prior to the morning meditation. And I thought, well, actually, we can we you know there is a different way to be, isn't there? So perhaps this can grow and this can spread and
Little by little, that's the thing, yeah. Little by little, good actions drip into the water pot like drops of water,
Lovely.
to misquote the
Well, thank you very much, Parami, for speaking to me.
Very welcome. Yeah. You're very welcome. I hope it goes well. I hope you don't get totally soaked and you sit today. And yeah, I'd be interested to hear how it goes.
Yeah, I'll stay in touch. I can't find the recording off button, but yeah, I'll
Okay,
thanks again for that, Parami. And
have a good day.
thank
Yeah.
you.
Excellent.
And that must have been about a year ago now. And so yeah, I'm well, the obviously the as every year passes, then the urgency presses really. So yeah, so I think now more than ever we need to take some action with the big sit really. So yeah, shall I shall we do the you asking me some questions then, Jeremy?
Yeah, I think we've covered a lot of it though, haven't we? I guess could you say more Buddhasevaka about what happens? What's it like? I mean, we've covered this a bit, but I mean, what do we do? What do we do? Yeah,
So,
because
we've kind of got a new way of doing it these days. I mean, a couple of Saturdays ago was the first time we've done it, but we start at the Buddhist Center at 1:30, and we have a shared meal, and then at 2 o'clock we go into one of the shrine rooms, and we have a little teaching, and we're doing it about the five precepts, the five positive and the five negative precepts. And so we went to Zaryatara last time, relatively recently ordained, and she gave a very good talk about the first precept with deeds of loving kindness I purify my body. And so from that, I mean, there's questions amongst our group, but then we as Parami was saying in that video, we then got our stuff together and walked down to the meditation spot, which, as I say, was just outside next. And so there was a bit of a, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I was on my scooter, so I went down there that way. But I think there was either some mindful walking or a bit of a chant recitation going on. So yeah, so and that's what we're going to be doing for the next 10, for the next 9 weeks, or for the next 9 months. We have one session every month. So yeah, and actually getting there. I mean, last time I was just handing out leaflets and people were scanning our QR codes, which we wore on our chest. We had three different banners, all, just basically saying what we were doing. These QR codes went to either the Facebook group about the Manchester Earth Sangha or the actual website that a picture Priya set up. So yeah, so we got a few bases covered in terms of the actual publicizing the events. But the meditators, they were just sitting peacefully, and as Primary was saying, I think it's quite a powerful thing to do, to sit in a street, and basically it's quite yeah, you can bring lots of stuff into your practice. And I always do the metta practice when I'm doing it, and having the having all of Manchester in my fifth stage, and taking it out. So it's a very positive thing really.
It is, isn't it? It's I was thinking of showing some quick photos for people to see
Yep.
what it looks like.
Yep.
There you go. I'll just scan through a few.
Cambridge.
I can work that out, how to actually scroll through them. Yes, there you go.
Oh, that's nice, that.
That's a Westfield, outside Westfield shopping centre in Stratford in East London. What was the biggest shopping centre in Europe? Maybe it still is. It was an amazing experience. I've only been to that one, that big sit once myself. Coordinators of the London Big Sit that have a really active group going. It's David and who you can see in that picture actually. David and Chrissy. Yeah, they sit there every month. And it was amazing. I found it's an amazing experience to be involved in. These crowded scenes, and we're just sitting peacefully, as you say, handing leaflets out to all people like this person on their graduation day coming to pick up a leaflet in Cambridge. We sit either inside or outside in Cambridge. Depends on the weather. There's two big shopping centres, and we could sit either outside or inside. Particularly like this, click today, collect tomorrow, which I think is not what John Lewis meant. In people are clicking today, and then they'll get the consequences tomorrow. Anyway, just a few random pictures. Lots of people want to chat. And it can be good or bad, or positive or negative, mostly positive. There's Yoga Ratna, who's very involved in Cambridge, one of the founders, really. There's Sarvajit there, you can see, Dara. Anyway, that's London again. Someone wasn't quite so keen on the leaflet there. But a lot of people, as you can see, are up for a conversation, and it's always non-judgmental and friendly, and we get sketched. Don't think I'm in that one. And it rains, and as you see, it's you're welcome to sit here, and people do. This is London again, inside. So I'd say that everyone sees us, whether they want to or not. Everyone sees us, and as you were saying, Buddhasevaka, it's like some of those people, it might have a little bit of an impact on, and like Parami was saying, most not. Some yes, maybe not then, but maybe later. Who knows? But for me, it feels powerful. Not expecting anything out of it. Don't attach myself to outcomes.
Yeah, there's a Manchester crew just there.
The crew there, yeah. Typical Manchester weather by the look of it. Perfect. Never get rain in Cambridge.
Oh,
Yeah, so there's a few pictures. I'd say that we never, I'd point out, we never, certainly in Cambridge, we never ask for permission to sit. We just sit. And we engage with security staff at the shopping centre if it's inside, in a friendly way. We reassure them we're going to be there for an hour and a quarter or something, that we're not in anyone's way. And what we've almost entirely found in the Cambridge and London ones I've been to is that security staff want to protect us. They support us. They're friendly and they're supportive. Don't ideally we wouldn't be there, but because we're friendly and cooperative, I mean, I was asked if we could leave once. I said no, we're just going to sit here. We're here until 3 o'clock, not in anyone's way. And he was fine with that as well, the security chief. Anyway, so it's always a very friendly atmosphere. I'm sure you find the same.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, great stuff. So I wonder now whether we should open up to questions because we've got 20 minutes left. So if there's any questions that we can take.
Has anyone tried it out or would like to, or curious about how, because I think our job in a way here is to encourage spread. And if you do a big sit in your city, we can include details on the big sit website, which I should put a link in the chat to, shouldn't I? Where we list the dates and add some photos to go along. But yeah, anyone would like to ask questions or suggest anything? Oh, Hannah, am I chairing this? I don't think I am. Hannah, go ahead.
Yes, I have a question. Thank you. I found this very inspiring, and I want to talk with my local sangha to see if this can be arranged, especially now with the very consumerism intense period we are heading into. I was curious if you invite other organization or groups, or is this like your local sangha specific or exclusive?
We kind of do it differently in Manchester because we've now got a mandate, and so the Board of Trustees didn't want us to go beyond our Buddhist Sangha, so we were kind of forced into that really. So there's a just a group of Buddhists. I know that Jeremy, you do it differently down there, don't you?
We do. We are supported by the Buddhist Centre in Cambridge. We are included on websites and newsletter things. By we, I mean Big Sit. But it's very much open to others, and we do encourage others, Hannah, to come along. You know, all of us, so Polly and there's quite a few of us in the kind of crew. There's no, by the way, there's no organization. It's just the Big Sit in Cambridge. Well, broadly, it's just a few of us kind of local coordinators that come together on Zoom calls every so often. But locally, it's just a bunch of people who wanted to make it happen, and we just work well together. Yeah, and we kind of invite through our contacts and our networks people to join us, and some do. So it's definitely not just a Tiratna thing. We have a lot of non-Tiratna people involved, but probably half and half, I'd say. And same in
Yeah.
London. I think there's a lot of people in the London big sits that are not. In fact, the main coordinator, David, he's not a Tiratna Buddhist. So, and we've had Quakers along. We've had quite a few, couple of vicars and other priests from Christian traditions and so on. I like that. I mean, okay, I'm a committed Buddhist, but we're all in this together, right? And there's common ground here. Yeah,
That's
definitely.
lovely. I have another question, if I can ask that one as well. I was thinking about this chair of that you are welcome to sit, and I love that. I wonder, are people curious, or do they want to receive instructions on meditation on meditating? And if so, do you give that?
Well, I guess it's again different in Manchester because you're all part of Tiratna who go along and you do us to people and you do your session beforehand. But in Cambridge, no, we don't give anyone, no one asks, and we haven't offered it. I mean, it's a silent, apart from the outreach, you know, it's a silent thing. So we don't really want to, you know, we do sometimes get into conversation at the kind of seated level, but it's not something we've encouraged as such, and we haven't discouraged it. And you don't have to meditate. You could just sit quietly, sit in contemplation, sit in silence, because that is a radical act. That is unusual. That's not what we expect to do. That's not what's expected, particularly in a shopping centre. And so, yeah. But why not? I mean, if you want to do that, then I don't know how you fit it in because it's because of the format. Where
Yeah,
are you, Hannah? Well,
it's quite noisy, isn't it? I don't know whether you'd be able to hear yourself or hear the teachers or anything, but
that's
maybe if you were sort of indoors in a shopping centre, that could work.
Yeah, it's weird, isn't it? I said it's silent, but of course it's not. It's noisy. But we are not speaking, apart from the outreaches. Where are you? What's it, what part of the world are you in, Hannah?
I'm in Stockholm, Sweden.
Uh-huh. Well,
please join our local conveners network, because yeah, you'd be extremely welcome to have something that's set up in Stockholm, because yeah, it's needed all over the world basically. So we'd be really grateful to have you on board.
Feel free to message us afterwards, Hannah, either through the website or if you know Buddhasevaka's email address.
Yeah.
Yes. Thank you.
Buddhasevaka@gmail.com. Yeah, thank you, Hannah. Yeah, it'd be great if you could join us.
Any other questions or things that who else is thinking of? I mean, this is not a sales pitch. It's just if you're inspired by it. Nyana Chandra?
Yeah, we are considering doing something similar in Essen, but only considering so far. So we have, we would like to do a walking meditation in December, and we have asked around. We want to do it with, if we find at least 10, better 20 people who join us. But for instance, we considered going through the official channel. So we already talked to the police, because it's like a demonstration. It's considered the same thing if you walk, you know, we explained it's a walking meditation, but Pia talked to the police. So we need to formally apply to be, you know, to get permission to do that. So I was surprised to hear that you even sit in shopping centers without asking for permission.
It's the disruptive activist in me. Like, I'm not going to conform to what a shopping center, you know, they're going to say no. And by the way, it's not just me, all of us. We just sit, yeah. But not in the way. And yeah, what we're doing is more important. And so if you've got the security people on board, if it's in a shopping center, or if the police have, yeah, the police have approached us before, certainly with Silent Rebellion, and always friendly, because we are giving off a friendly kind of we're giving a loving vibe. You know, we're not, it's not a demonstration. It is in a way, but it's not a protest. It is in a way, but it's also doesn't look like that. So I would say don't apply, don't do the formalities, just get on with it. That's my view.
I like it, but I'm not sure my colleagues agree.
Okay, and of course you're in a different country to us, so I don't know what the culture's like. Well, happy to talk, I mean, I'm sure all of us are happy to talk to you more about that, if you like, about our experiences of it. Akash Raja, go for it.
Yeah, thanks, Jeremy. So I'm in Shrewsbury, and we've done something slightly different, which is to sit on traffic roundabouts. So we sit on kind of nodal points in the local traffic system. And I'm quite interested in the sort of interface between these green spaces and traffic. And we get quite close to people, particularly when they're waiting, you know, when they're queuing up. And in some ways, I think us sitting there highlights the sort of, you know, there's a sort of disparity between what we're doing, and they're all sitting queuing up in their cars at traffic lights. You know, it might not be brilliant for our lungs, but we do get quite a lot of kind of supportive, you know, people sort of honking their horns and stuff. And it's just a way to be visible to quite a lot of people. As you know, around about morning rush hour, there's a lot of people passing by. And we did this particularly during the Glasgow COP conference with the placards. And so I think there's another COP coming up, so I'd be quite keen to do that again.
Sounds great. Yeah. I mean, anything that of this sort of format, I think could be powerful. I mean, as you found, didn't you in Shrewsbury do a big sit once or twice, or are you doing it?
We've sat in public in various places, but never with this sort of with an agenda. Though we have once or twice. That's not true. In the local park, but not in the shopping centre. That's an interesting take on it. And I think I'd be inclined to follow your lead and just do it and not ask for permission.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, great. Again, if you want to talk about tactics or experiences about and doing a shopping centre style, then
yeah, thank you.
Get in touch. Yeah, great. I encourage people to have a look at the website, and you'll see the kind of terminology we use, slightly playful language, which doesn't work for everyone. And more pictures there.
Good, great. I think if there's no more questions, shall we end the session?
Oh yeah, I'm going to say something else. In terms of communication or publicity, I think. Just so you know, it's basically not. We don't do a great deal, and we could do more. And I think the personal contacts, you know, approaching other groups through contacts is the most powerful way of attracting people to join in through friendships and networks. But we have a weekly newsletter in Cambridge, although it's much wider than Cambridge. We have a few hundred people for Silent Rebellion, and we just include Big Sit in that, the next dates and pictures and things. So weekly kind of MailChimp type thing. The website, of course, the Instagram we use, although not as much as I'd like. So find us on Instagram if you use it. And the leaflet is absolutely key to communicating something, you know, in situ of why we're there for those who don't want to actually talk. Because actually it's a very imaginative thing, and it's going to trigger some people's imagination and not others. And it's hard to communicate with the banners, the written word and the banners and the leaflets, something that, as I was saying earlier, that's a bit more subtle and complicated about feelings and so on.
Yeah, I've got a couple of, I suppose I can share my screen. Show you the banners and things that I wonder if people can see this. I mean, that's the leaflet that we're using. That's the banner, the A0 banner that we're painting. And we just, we all wear, I don't know if you can see the QR codes and the little banners around people's necks that we wear. So that works for us as well.
And that's very specific to Manchester, because some of the other cities use the more generic Big Sit thing brand messaging. We don't call it Earth Sangha or anything like that. We're very much talking to from a broad perspective to a broad perspective, if you see what I mean. So it's like anyone who kind of gives a sit for life on Earth, come and join us or look at us.
Yeah. No, I think we need to alter our mandate to kind of catch a wide. Well, this is something for us in the cooler to talk about, but yeah, I think the more people, the better, really.
It looks like you get quite a good number of people along there in Manchester.
Yeah, no, it's okay. And I'm really pleased to hear that you got 50 on your first week. Yeah, we had about 30, you know, about a year ago this month. But I mean, the numbers are falling off, but that's how it goes, really, sometimes, isn't it? We just need to get in there before, you know, we have to. I mean, I think we probably have to get involved at this time, but I mean, everyone's not quite on board with it, but hopefully in time they will be.
Yeah.
Good stuff.
Well, thanks everyone for coming along. I hope it's been interesting, and if you've got any questions or want to set one up, try it out. Just get in touch with any of us, and yeah, thanks for your questions too.
Yeah, thank you, Jeremy. Yeah, that was great.
Thank you. Yeah.